Hello everyone and welcome back to my YouTube channel. I thought I'd come with a different type of video this week and I'm going to interview my own accountant, who is Peter Jarman of PJCO. Welcome Peter.
Hello everybody.
So thanks for coming on and agreeing to be interviewed. I just have so many questions that people have been asking me that I thought it'd be great to come on here and just hash it out and go over some of the questions that I've been asked. So to start with, being that we're based down here in Shoreham, which is West Sussex, I guess I want to kick it off with a good question, and that would be, does location matter when it comes to picking an accounting firm?
Well, Justin, I don't think today it really matters. I mean, most people, when they're having their accounts done, are going to use cloud accounting software. That cloud accounting software, as it says, is in the cloud. So the information, the records are all going to be held in the cloud. Where your accountant is doesn't really matter in that case, because the accountant can just get hold of that information. If you're in Brighton and they're in Edinburgh, they can just get hold of that information through the cloud, chat to you on the phone, chat to you via webinar, and certainly for us it doesn't now matter. We have clients all over the country, and it's equally as easy to deal with someone in Scotland as it is to deal with someone in Brighton. So I don't think that really matters. If you were keeping all your records in paper format and you had to take them along to your accountant, well, firstly, I would say, don't do that. And secondly, then location really matters and you've got to find someone very close to hand.
Fine. No, which is what I thought the case was. And with what you said there about cloud-based accounting, how important do you think it is to, for example, a new property investor, being that this is a property channel, how important do you think it is for someone to be using like QuickBooks, Receipt Bank, you know, that sort of bookkeeping software from the start? Is that quite an important thing?
I think it's absolutely vital, to be fair. You know, when you've got a new business, you're starting to either do this as a sole trader or a limited company, you've got to deal with all the tax records. And in doing that, there's a whole load of laws that you have to comply by.
Yeah.
Those are obviously include accounting. How do you record down all your transactions? How do you keep them all in order? And also, how do you keep hold of all your expense receipts? You know, if in a few years' time you're going to have to show HMRC that you spent £2,000 repairing that bathroom, how are you going to keep hold of that receipt to prove you'd spent it? Well, that's where this cloud software really comes to its fruition and comes to really work well for you, because the cloud software enables you to take your bank account and simply draw it straight into the software. In doing that, you can often automate a lot of the processes, especially for property developers and property rental companies. You know, you've got rent coming in every month from the same tenant. You can set a rule in place that says that rent is always going to be rent for flat 123 XYZ Street. And so you, as the business owner, don't have to do any accounting to record that. You set the rule up to say that's where it's always going.
And it matches it.
And it matches. And similarly with the letting agents' fees. You know, the same letting agents are going to happen at the same time. And so you can set rules up to match all of those. But probably most importantly is the use of something like Receipts Bank to keep a record of all your receipts. The area where we find most new business owners go wrong is that they don't manage to organise their receipts in a really organised and efficient manner. You know, they have they go off and they start improving that property. They go down to Travis Perkins, buy something there, put that receipt in their car, tuck it in the glove box or something, come to find it a bit later and can't find it. They know they bought it from Travis Perkins, so they still just record it down. And then a few years later, HMRC come along and say, right, now we want to have a look at your records. We want to have a look and see that you've got all the receipts that match what you're claiming as an expenses to reduce down your tax.
Of course.
And of course, you can't find it. It was in your glove box 3 years ago. You then put it in a filing cabinet A to F, or Travis Perkins T to Z. You can't find that filing cabinet, that file. So HMRC are now asking for the invoice. You can't find it. That causes a problem, because they might not now allow you to claim that expense. And you may well have to pay tax on that expense. So Receipts Bank really comes in and works on your behalf, because all you do is you take, as you know, you take a photo of that receipt as you walk out of the Travis Perkins branch.
Yeah.
Or even better, you get Travis Perkins to email it to you straight away.
Yeah, that's a good idea.
And you've got a photo of that receipt. The Receipts Bank will read that receipt, and it'll post it into your QuickBooks. It'll read it and say, oh, this is repairs. If you've put it on there, it's for 123 XYZ Street, and it'll post it into your QuickBooks. On top of that, it'll put a picture of the receipt in QuickBooks.
Yeah.
So now in 3 years' time, when you come and have a VAT inspection, a tax inspection, you're not going to be registered for VAT. when you have a tax inspection, HMRC come along and say, can I see that receipt for that bathroom that you fitted?
Yeah.
You go to QuickBooks, you look at the bottom of that expense, and there's a picture of the receipt, and you send it on to HMRC. Everything's tied up, neat and tidy.
Makes sense.
On top of that, you know, your house, your flat, isn't full of filing cabinets with paper in.
Yeah.
It's all stored digitally.
So, yeah, I've definitely noticed the benefits already, and just in comparison to when I did my accounts with you for a previous business that I owned, and I did a spreadsheet and, you know, kind of that older style of, you know, running your books, it's still definitely possible and obviously keeps costs down. But from my personal experience, actually, if you from day one set everything up with the accountant, you know, with the software, I think it's makes life so much easier. Now I just log on once a month for 10 minutes, just check that all of the bank stream is matched up, and it's quite nice to look at as well.
And you mentioned cost there as well. I mean, today it is cheaper for you to run your accounts using cloud software and Receipts Bank than it is to put them on a spreadsheet, because for your accountant, it's an awful lot more organised and a lot easier to access. So therefore, the cost of producing those accounts is less.
It saves you
a bit of time. Yeah, so today, if you came along to us with spreadsheets and filed pieces of paper, your cost will be higher than if you said, well, I'll put all this on QuickBooks and Receipts Bank.
Yeah.
The cost will be down under that route because it's so much more organised.
Makes sense. Yeah, makes sense. And the next thing that I wanted to just cover, because it's obviously very big in the property world, and that is the what is known as Section 24, which has been, I believe, phased in over 3 or 4 years.
Yeah,
is that
4 years.
Four years. And now we are into the first full year.
I think you're into the third full year. Right. Yeah, it's getting worse by the year.
Yeah.
So what is Section 24?
That would be great. Yeah, okay. Just to touch on it.
Right. So what it is that in the past, you had some rental income and you had some mortgage interest. And to work out your tax liability, you took the rental income that you had, you knocked off the mortgage interest cost, and you had a profit. And that profit would be taxed at whatever rate you personally were paying in tax.
Yep.
So if you were a 20% taxpayer, you'd pay 20% on that difference between the rent and the mortgage interest. If you're a 40% taxpayer, it'd be 40% or
45%. Right.
Yeah. HMRC then decided that life was too good for buy-to-letters. Believe it or not. Yeah. They decided that it was too easy to make money out of buy-to-let.
Yeah.
And they were going to penalise it in terms of tax. So what they suggested, what they decided to do, was they were going to allow you to have your rental income at your highest rate of tax, but your mortgage interest would only ever receive basic rate, 20% tax relief.
I see.
Yeah.
Yep.
Now, if I turn this into a really sort of a large example, if you've built up your property portfolio quite considerably, and you've got £1 million worth of rents, and you've geared up and you've got £800,000 worth of mortgage interest, on that property portfolio, you're making £200,000 a year.
Yes.
You're quite happy with your profit.
Yeah.
Yep. Because you're making £200,000 a year out of the portfolio. But now, as these rules, Section 24, come in, the £1 million worth of rent get taxed at 45%, £450,000.
Yeah.
The £800,000 worth of mortgage interest receives tax relief at 20%, £160,000.
Yes.
And so your tax liability on £200,000 worth of buy-to-let profit is £450,000 minus £160,000,
£290,000.
So you've earned yourself £200,000, but you're going to pay £290,000 in tax. So your tax liability is bigger than your profits.
So you're paying 90,000 for the benefit of owning those properties and renting them out, yeah, effectively.
So this is fine if you're a barrister in London and you've got an extra income of a few hundred thousand pounds,
yeah,
you could afford to fund the 90,000.
Yeah.
But if you're not, it's actually costing you more in tax than you could earn in profit because of this tax change. Now, they've brought that tax change in across 4 years.
Yeah.
Don't ask me today which year it started from, but I think we're in year three okay. of the 4 years.
Yeah.
The first year,
yeah,
25% of the interest was at basic rate, and the 75% of the interest, you got tax relief at your highest rate.
Okay.
The second year, it was 50% at basic rate,
yeah,
50% at higher rate. And by the fourth year, it's all at basic rate.
Yeah.
So over these years, the tax liabilities on buy-to-letters keep going up. If your profit stayed the same, your tax liabilities keep going up if you're a higher rate taxpayer.
Yes.
If you're a basic rate taxpayer, so your income is under £50,000, including your rental income,
yeah,
then Section 24 doesn't make any difference to you at all, because you're paying basic rate tax on your rental income, mm-hmm, 20% tax on your rental income,
yeah,
and you're getting 20% tax relief on your mortgage interest.
I see.
So if you earn less than 50,000, including your rental income, you don't need to think about Section 24.
Okay.
But if you are building up a property portfolio and you own it personally,
yeah,
then Section 24 soon becomes a problem.
Yes.
Because you could be earning, let's say, 30,000 a year, and you could have £50,000 worth of rental income.
Yeah.
So your total income now will be 80,000.
Yeah.
No matter how much mortgage interest you pay on it. So 30,000 of your rental income will always be taxed at 40%.
Right, I see.
And then your mortgage interest will only ever receive 20% tax relief on it.
So again, you could end up paying.
You could end up paying a higher figure.
Yes.
But it becomes more of a problem the bigger your portfolio gets. So if you're really thinking about building up a portfolio of properties,
yeah,
then you know you've got to think from the start: is it worthwhile me starting as a sole trader in my own name?
Yeah.
Or should I start as a limited company? And Section 24 doesn't apply to limited companies.
And would it, in a very basic terms, because obviously there's give and take depending on what someone's salary would be, but if someone was working full time and starting a portfolio and planning to build it up and obviously earn income from the portfolio, as well as, say, for example, earning £30,000, does it make sense for them, therefore, to probably look down the route of a limited company?
I think everyone's position is slightly different,
yeah,
because it depends what you're really planning to do. If you were a basic rate taxpayer and you were looking to get one buy to let, and that buy to let was still going to keep you in basic rates of tax,
yeah,
you would probably say it's better to buy it in your own name.
Yeah,
you're not losing out tax wise because mm-hmm. of Section 24. When you buy properties in your own name, when you sell them, the capital gains tax under current rules is slightly cheaper,
yeah,
if you own it personally as against in a company.
Yeah.
And certainly if you own the property personally rather than in a company, you haven't got to pay for the compliance cost of the company as well.
Okay.
So if you're in that route where you're thinking I'm going to get one property, perhaps two, but I'm going to stay in basic rates,
yes,
yeah, then it makes sense to buy those properties in your own name.
Yeah.
But if you're planning to take over the world with a portfolio of buy-to-lets,
yeah,
and you know that's what your plan is, it probably makes sense to start in all within a company.
Okay.
Saying that, quite a few people do one or two buy-to-lets in their own name,
yeah,
and then as they get more used to it, the rest go into a company. So having a combination gives you an advantage as well, because we know what the tax rules are today,
yeah,
but we don't know what the tax rules are in 5 or 10 years' time. And if you've got some properties in your own name and in 5 or 10 years' time it's better to sell those than the ones in the company, you've got a bit more choice.
Yeah, because again, I think that's a bit, not a myth, but that's something that people aren't aware of, that you could quite happily split your buy-to-lets between your own name and your limited company. You don't have to open a limited company and just always buy within that company. You can have both,
yeah. Yeah. And you know, it's quite normal to have some buy-to-lets in your own name and some in a company,
yeah,
as you start to build a bigger and bigger portfolio.
Which is quite a good idea, really, I think, maybe to diversify a bit. So
yeah, I think the only time that isn't a good idea, if you're already a 45% taxpayer,
then
you might not choose to have any more in your own name.
Got it. Okay, that's good. Thanks, Peter. Next on my list would be, we've covered quite a lot of them, which is good, but I often get asked by people on YouTube and on Instagram as to, does someone need to go and get a property specialist accountant, or would a more, I don't know what the term is, and sorry if I get this wrong, a more generic accountant be okay? You know, what are your thoughts on a normal accounting firm versus what, you know, a lot of people are saying to me, I can get a property specialist accountant, but they're £150 a month, which seems incredibly high to me for, you know, one or two buy-to-lets.
Right. Yeah, I mean, I think that, first of all, you have to get on with your accountant, number one.
Yeah.
Whether they're a specialist or they're a GP, a generalist, effectively,
yeah,
you need to get on with them, and you need to be able to ask them questions and get replies that you, yes, can understand.
Yeah.
So, first off, work with people you like working with,
yeah,
and you can understand. Yeah. And when you ask them a question, they give you a reply that you do understand.
Yeah.
Generally, if you've got a property portfolio and you've got it in a company, there isn't anything too difficult about that. It just happens that you happen to own a company and you happen to have a few properties in there. And most accountants who are non-specialist will be able to deal with that.
Yeah.
Some will have more experience of dealing with that than others. So some will say, yes, I can deal with that. But if you ask me the difference between holding that property in your own name and holding it in a company, I can't tell you.
Yeah.
Well, if they couldn't tell you that, I probably wouldn't go with them in the first place.
Yeah.
So, you know, you need to inquire into them and find out what they really know.
Yeah.
So, you know, ask them, you know, should I hold this in my own name, should I hold this in a company, what are the pros and cons?
Yes.
If they're able to give you those, they probably understand enough about the basic compliance and the basic running of property within a company or property in your own name.
Yeah.
Yep. And when you've got a company running along like that, that's all you need most years. You know, most of the time you're just having these properties in a company, recording down their rents, recording down their expenses, producing company accounts, sending in the tax returns to HMRC, paying any tax that's due, and going on to the next year.
Yeah.
Straightforward compliance work. Any generalist accountant that's got some experience of property should be able to do that for you.
Okay.
So number one question is, ask them and speak to them and see, yeah, whether you like them in the first place.
Whether you get on with them, yeah, and whether they explain things that's, yeah, on a reasonable level for, yeah, someone new like me. That's what I guess, apart from the fact, you know, we're local, we've got previous dealings. I think what's quite useful is you always explain it in a way in which I can understand it. You know, you keep it and you sort of probably dumb it down a bit so that the average person can come in and really get an idea on how to do accounting and what it involves.
It's trying to get the right measure,
yeah,
for each person.
Yeah.
But then saying that, I think if any accountant comes along to you and says, I know, I'm a property specialist, I, yeah, know everything.
Yeah.
That's highly unlikely.
Okay.
And yeah, certainly, yeah, we have plenty of properties in companies.
Yeah.
But we wouldn't say we're specialists in it.
Mm-hmm.
There will be specialist areas,
yeah,
that people that just deal with that specialism, that's their only job.
Yeah.
Now, for us as accountants, we could be dealing with a buy-to-letter, we could be dealing with someone that's got a coffee shop,
yeah,
or an engineering factory, but generally we're dealing with owner-managers of companies.
Yes.
And there will be some accountants that are specialist in specific areas of tax around buy-to-let.
Yeah.
In particular, the area you have to be most careful of is if you've built up a portfolio of buy-to-lets and you're now thinking about moving that portfolio from your own name,
yeah,
or yours and your wife's name, and moving it into a company.
Yes.
There are people out there that say, we can get all this done for you and we can stop any tax liabilities when you move it into the company.
Yeah.
And perhaps we can reduce down the stamp duty liabilities as well. Now, when that's happening, that is a specialist skill.
Yes.
And if you're going to go down those routes, then you really need to research that specialist.
Yeah.
I liken this to, you know, you've, you've got a health issue,
yeah.
and you go to your GP, he refers you on to a specialist for a heart condition, you probably research that heart specialist to see it's the right one
yeah.
that should be dealing with your heart.
Yes.
Exactly the same applies to your property portfolio. You suddenly decide that this portfolio needs reconstructing,
yeah.
it needs putting it into a company, and there will be, when you search on Google, a number of people that say, we're property specialists, we can move this into a company for you, and we can reduce down your taxes, your stamp duty,
yeah.
and your capital gains tax. I think those people you need to, you're only going to need to deal with once while
yes.
they deal with it.
Yeah.
So it's very much a matter, you get handed over to them, they do this specialist work, and they then give the company back to your original accountant.
Yes.
But you need to research them well, because there's a lot of difference between the people who really know what they're doing
mm-hmm.
and the people who say they know what they're doing or market well
yeah.
To get people to hand over their property portfolios
yeah.
in.
Yeah.
I mean, I was talking to you earlier, the one thing that you do need to check when you are dealing with a specialist or an accountant for this matter
yeah.
is check and see if they're qualified. I mean, I was telling you, if you didn't
yeah,
know,
yeah.
that actually you could be a taxi driver yesterday and a tax accountant today.
So I didn't realise that.
Yeah,
so
you know, check to see that your accountant is qualified. If you're going for those specialisms, definitely check with other people who've gone through the process
yeah.
to make sure that everything turned out as it should.
Check on their experience.
Their experience and their historic experience. Because
yeah.
it's possible to move all these things into a company
yeah.
and 2 or 3 years later,
yeah.
HMRC come along and say, sorry, that didn't work. And you go back to your specialist and he isn't anywhere to be found. Then you've got a problem.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, you know, again, you know, seeing that whoever you go to do that specialist work, you research them
yeah.
and you know
they're
going to be here. That specialism is going to be generally very expensive.
Yeah.
When you are moving a portfolio of property from your own name via a partnership into a limited company
yeah.
and you're managing to reduce down your stamp duty and you're managing to get rid of your capital gains tax,
yeah.
You could be saving a lot of tax. And generally, to do it properly, you need all the paperwork in place in the right way. Time matters a lot, so a lot of these things take 2 years or 3 years to actually process.
Yeah.
And the fees for doing it can be quite considerable. You know, okay. it can be five figures, they can be six figures
yeah.
in some cases.
Yeah, yeah.
But you might be paying a five figure fee to get this changed to save a six figure tax liability.
Yeah.
And again, you know, that particular specialism is much more expensive than your general compliance of your company. So, you know, it will be expensive. Choose the right person, research
yeah.
them, get advice from other people
that
have used
gone
them.
Through it. Good, okay. And so just to round up on that, I guess that point, is it fair, again, to just say that going with, you know, an accountant that you like, that's qualified, that is perhaps more on the generic level, is probably best for someone that's a brand new property investor, because that's who I tend to get watching, someone that's about to open a limited company or wondering if they should open a limited company. And if they went down that route, is it best to work with, you know, a firm like yourself who have got experience in property, but the actual working with a property tax specialist doesn't come until you've perhaps got a much bigger portfolio and then you have an actual need and want, and perhaps, as you say, transferring. Is that right, kind of, to summarise?
Yeah, I think
that's
yeah. right. I think, you know, the general year-to-year compliance can
yeah.
be done by your accountant that you have your day-to-day relationship
yeah.
with, effectively,
yeah.
that you can phone up and ask them. That accountant will, if he's worth his salt, when it's something that's outside of his experience, he'll pass you on to the specialist,
yeah.
get that thing done, and then you'll come back to the accountant again. Hopefully, if you've got a good relationship with that
yeah.
accountant.
Yeah.
But that's the way I see it working. As I say, I wouldn't believe anyone that says, I know all about
everything.
Property, I'm a specialist in everything, because it simply isn't possible.
Yeah.
You could be a specialist in capital gains, but you won't be in stamp duty as well. And so, you know, it's not very likely that you're going to come across this specialist that knows everything. And if you do, you're going to pay over the odds for the compliance work, the
yeah.
standard stuff that happens every year.
For
the benefit
of
everything else, when
yeah.
you only need the specialism every 10 years.
Yes, yeah, okay, no, that's good, no, thank you for that. And As we're about 24, 25 minutes in, and I want to keep it to a reasonable length. I think that's answered the main bulk of questions that I get, and I hope that's really helpful. If someone wants to perhaps look at working with you and PJCO, how can they contact you?
Can find us on search for www.peterjarman.com. Alternatively, look for PJCO Accountants on YouTube, Twitter, Instagram, and TikTok as well. Or phone us 01273 441187.
Brilliant, because you have your own YouTube as well. For anyone that's watching this on YouTube, you've got your own.
We have our own YouTube page, mainly for helping people with their QuickBooks. So if you've got a particular problem doing something in QuickBooks, you can go to the YouTube channel, see how to do it, and carry on without necessarily calling us at 2 o'clock at night or something.
Well, good. Well, thanks very much. And more information, peterjarman.com, and reach out to Peter, or I can put you in touch. But thank you for watching another episode. Thank you. Cheers.
Bye.